Good morning, church. Welcome to our Sunday service. Let's pray before we begin. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for what you've been doing. God, we know that you have, God, been taking care of us throughout this season, God, and as we move, God, and things are beginning to change and move forward, we know, God, that you will continue, God, to protect us, to be with us, to speak to us and guide us, Lord. So we thank you, God. We pray, God, that we will continue, Lord, to put you first in everything, that we will not forget, Lord, who you are and what you have been, God, to us, God. So, Lord, we continue, God, to honor you, to praise you. And God, let's lift up all our worship, God, to you. So we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Singing hallelujah to our crown you with every crown for the way you loved us. Oh, high King of heaven, we crown you the Lord of all. I have watched how you drove back the sea and swallowed up my every fear. I have walked from the shore to the deep, and through it all, you were there. Mighty Redeemer, strong to deliver. His praise will never, never fail throughout eternity. Oh, hail Redeemer, hail, for he has died for me. His praise will never, ever fail.
crown you with every crown. For the way you saved us, we crown you with every crown. For the way you loved us, oh, our King of Heaven, we crown you the Lord of all.
Jesus, we thank you. God, you are our King, the Lord of Lords. And God, we put our trust, Lord, in you. God, we've seen what you can do. And God, let us not forget, God. Let us put it before us, Lord. Let us meditate, God, on what you have said to us every day, Lord. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Welcome to our Sunday service. Hope all of you are doing well in your families. Since things are now open, let's continue to pray and ask God for His protection over us as we go back and fro through work and our routines, and even when we go out of our houses. Let's pray that God will continue to be with us, and we will be vigilant in doing the right things. Let's also keep the physical services in mind and pray as we prepare for all the things that needs to be done in the coming weeks. Please also do feel free to contact the church leadership if you need any prayer or support or help in any way. Let us continue to also pray for each other, asking God for opportunities to be His voice and His hands, to be a blessing to the people around us. Let's pray before we go into the Word of God. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your kindness, Lord. Thank you for seeing us through the many months, Lord. And God, as things open, be with us, Lord. I pray for your word, and I ask that you speak to us, that you'll open our hearts, Lord, towards you, Lord, in response to the truth of your kingdom, Lord. And Holy Spirit, we call upon you, Lord, to come and fill every home with that awe, with that love, that we know, God, you are speaking, you are good. And Lord, your care for us, your mercy for us is real. In Jesus' name, Father, we pray. Amen, Lord. So today, our sermon title is called The Essence of Christianity. And it's taken from this famous parable of Jesus, in Luke 10, 25 to 37. Let's look at the passage. Let me read. On one occasion, an expert of the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law? He replied. How do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and And when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. But he put the man on his donkey and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. "Look after him," he said, "and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" The expert of the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go, do likewise." So, just to give you a little background on what's really happening here. And so, if you read chapter 10, you realize that just before this event, Jesus sent out 72 of his followers around and in preparation of his moving from town to town. And there was a great thing that happened. And you can see Jesus, all his disciples came back and they were so happy of what they saw and what they heard. And Jesus was thrilled. And in his prayer, Jesus explained a lot of things. And he thanked his Father for opening the eyes, opening things up to the simple people that went out in his name. And it's just amazing. And just after this event, this takes place. And in this story, this conversation is actually between 2 people. It's between Jesus and a lawyer, an expert of the law. And this guy, of course, he is an expert of the law of Moses. If you read the commentaries, you can see that he has spent his whole life actually studying the law, interpreting it, and teaching it in the synagogues. And this was his profession, and one who was actually recognized as an expert in the Jewish law. So if we think of lawyers today, we think of those who practice civil or criminal law. A lawyer in Israel was an expert in the law of Moses. And this law included not only the laws that govern the religious community, but also the laws that govern the state. And Old Testament Israel was a theocracy, meaning that there was no separation between the church or the synagogues and the state. The civil laws were governed by the same rules that govern the cultus, the system or variety of religious worship, or the religious life of the people. On the contrary, there was Jesus, an itinerant rabbi, had received from the masses the title of a teacher. There's no record in the New Testament of Jesus studying under any great rabbis or theologians or of his era, or having even earned a degree that would have given him this kind of academic credibility. But we're told again and again that he was the one having authority. He spoke like the one having authority, because his mentor was his Father, God, in heaven, who revealed many things to his Son incarnate. So here we are told that he stood up to the test, up and tested Jesus. He tested Jesus by asking him one fundamental question about those things related to the law of God, saying in the words, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" So ultimately, this question actually evokes our thoughts around the idea of what is at the core of our Christianity, our beliefs. Many of us would like to think that it is all about doing good, just like what we think this parable is suggesting. Some will also think that because of the good we do, we are automatically entitled for eternal life that was promised by Jesus. We see how Jesus actually breaks this down. He breaks this idea with a parable of the Good Samaritan. So if you can think about the parable of the Good Samaritan, people have used it in many ways. It's always tied to the idea of helping the person in need, and they have a lot of organizations within this idea and how they help people around. But let's look at the passage and see what Jesus is really dealing with here. So the first thing is to understand the place of the law. So we see from verse 25 to 28, there are a few questions and answers that are going in between Jesus and the lawyer. So the first one is, what must I do to inherit eternal life? So we often, very often, our Christianity always starts with this very familiar question, what must I do? So when we evaluate this question, we realize that we are always working on the doing part. Let's help the poor, let's get this done, let's serve here, let's, you know, even when we come in contact with difficult situations that people have, and it's always about doing. We want to help their needs. We want to go quickly and try to solve things, and that's how it starts. Sometimes it becomes, we become very good in doing this stuff. We forget the meaning or purpose of that we do. Or sometimes we become tired of trying to do and maybe failing at it more than ever. And all this leads to our hearts becoming hard and distant from God than ever before. Disappointments, burnouts, and a lot of times losing sight of our calling and purposes. So I think most of us are very, very familiar with this, and a lot of times we ourselves have gotten disappointed and over the things we have done and the responses we receive. And sometimes by doing and doing and doing, we come to a place where we feel burnout. And what this does is eventually we lose sight of God's calling over our lives. We stay distant. We just move away. We become dormant Christians. We just do what we ought to do at the minimal that it takes. But here we see Jesus asking another question to answer the question that the lawyer is. He says, what is written in the law? And how do you read it? Remember, this guy, again, is an expert. He knows the law very well. So the deep issue that Jesus is trying to address is the way we see and acknowledge the scriptures. So a lot of times our tendency is to be biased when we read the scripture and it comes to us. And just like this guy, you know, and it always starts with what I do, and we try to adjust. So this partially tends to modify or adjust the truth and brings us to some kind of compromise, which hinders the work of transformation that it was intended to do. So we can see this idea when Jesus asked this man, how do you read it? He's like asking you, what do you think about it? So we see here that the lawyer, the expert, gave his answer spot on, quoting from Deuteronomy 6, 5. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. And also quoting Leviticus, the same law. You shall not hate your brother in your heart, but you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the son of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I, the Lord. So when we read this, why did this guy or this lawyer quote this? It's actually he's quoting the Shema. The Shema refers to a couple of lines from the book of Deuteronomy, especially chapter 6, 4, and 5. And it's like their daily prayer in ancient Israel traditions. If you take today's time, it's like the Lord's Prayer and how it's repeated again and again and in our own traditions. And this is something that is memorized and repeated a few times a day, and it is also tied to the end of their cloaks, right? Their coat. It's like a tassel that hangs there, and it's there to remind them of the Shema. And Jesus replies this, guys, you have answered correctly. Yeah. So we see that Jesus acknowledges that he knows, and that the lawyer knows, and that he has said it right. So let me just give you a perspective here. There are three functions of the law when we think about the law. And so the first part of it is the law is a mirror. It's reflecting to us both the perfect righteousness of God and our own sinful and shortcomings. So when we look at the scriptures, it's supposed to show us who God is and where we are. So that's the first function. And the second function, it is to restrain evil. So basically, the law is put in place so that evil is restrained. You can control evil in a sense, and that's why you have punishments. And when you read the Old Testament in Deuteronomy and Leviticus, you can see there's a lot of consequences to not following the law, and some of it is very demanding. It's until the place where you are put to death, and so that's the second function. But the law cannot change the heart. It doesn't. It probably brings fear. It brings you to certain awareness of what the consequences are, but it doesn't change the heart in any way. The third function of the law, it guides the renewed into the good works that God has planned for them. And the law tells God's children what will please their Heavenly Father. So it actually tells us what God requires of us, what he is asking of us, what will make him happy. And so these are the three functions. It acts as a mirror. It shows us who we are and who God is. It restrains what is evil, but it doesn't have the power to change our heart. It guides. It shows us what pleases God himself. So, but then Jesus makes this astounding point turns everything upside down. He says to this lawyer, do this and you will live. And so if you think of all the functions of the law, and when somebody tells you that this is where the major struggle is, right? If you understand all that I just explained, then we will only come to one single conclusion. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So we find ourselves basically struggling because we are reluctant to admit of our shortcoming. when the Bible says, do not lie, and we go about our daily lives, we try to categorize the lies. This is really bad lies. I'm doing white lies, so it's not really bad. And so we go on to in trying to justify the errors that the scripture demands of us. And the more we do it, the more we understand that we just can't keep up with the law, and we can't keep up in following the laws. And that's it. We always find ways to make it easier for us. And you can look at the world today and the make it easier, the reluctance to admit the flaws of our nature and our disbeliefs has led the world into some crazy spin. Everything is okay now. Everything looks okay if you can put it into some logical, right sense. And when we speak of these things, you can see how twisted the heart is. And likewise, we see in verse 29, what the Bible says, or what the author writes is, but he wanted to justify himself. And this is the lawyer. He asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? So if you really read the Levitical, the chapters of this, and it doesn't end in chapter 17. If you continue to read, it goes on and on and on, and you look at Leviticus 19, 33 and 34, and how the whole idea of what do you call it, caring for your neighbor, loving your neighbor as yourself, it goes on to explain. And here it says, when a stranger, in 1933 to 34, it says, when a stranger sojourns with you in your land, you shall not do him wrong. You shall treat the stranger who sojourns with you as native among you, and you shall love him as yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. And you see the tie between what you went through and the whole idea of loving your neighbor. It ties to the place where God delivered you to the place where understanding how to love someone else. And here the lawyer is taking out certain things and setting new boundaries to what he thinks this is. And you can see, if you read the history of Israel, you can understand that the Israelites or the Jewish people, they hate the Samaritans. And what has happened is this hatred has gone out of proportion. There is a separate nation. Separate group of people. They don't tie. They don't sit together. So you can understand in the book of Matthew and all this. They explain how this differences are treated and how these people are treated. They are treated as downcast. They are low caste people. They're just out of the family of the Jewish people. And this is inside the heart of this lawyer. Thus, the only way he's justifying himself, saying that I can love my neighbor is this much of people, and I love the people that I know, and the people that I like, and the people that I want to love, and the people that I hate, and the people that don't agree with me, I totally will. And this is where Jesus, instead of he uses the Samaritan as the hero in his approach to explain to this. So we move on to the next part, and we see the story of the Good Samaritan, and here it shows what is within our hearts. So if you read the story, you can understand that there is a man who is going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he gets mugged by a bunch of robbers and left there beaten, stripped of his clothes. And the Bible, the story, Jesus uses the word half dead. He's lying down there without any motion, just lying down there waiting to die. So you have two people that is here, you know, and so that crosses by him, and the parable start with an obvious with the obvious problem, you know, and the problem is there is a man in dire need for help. Jesus says that this is what happens, you know, he's being attacked. He was moving from one place to another, and now he has fallen into the hands of robbers, and they ambushed him, and they stripped him of his clothes, they beat him, they left him there. And then Jesus says that there are two people, and these two people are they are associates of the temple, the Levites and the Pharisees. So what it means is they understand the religious practices, they know the law of God, they know the traditions, they understand the act of that religiousness. And what Jesus also says is this: two of them simply left the man who is in dire need right there. And the Bible uses the word move to the other side. They just distanced themselves and walked away. So the deep question is, oh, why? Why did they do that? Of course, it's not written here in the text. But when we carefully look at the text and reflect on it, you would actually come out with some interesting conclusions, such as, you know, there's fear, maybe they were afraid that the robbers might just be there, somewhere around. When they go to help him, they might get into trouble. Second is the whole idea of inconvenience. If I help, then I might get into maybe a legal issue. Or I must send him to the hospital. That is going to be troublesome. Or it might cost me time or money that I'm not willing to put there. I'm not willing to risk anything. I'm not willing to give anything. I'm not willing to put down anything for what I see, or the other thing is the whole idea of being judgmental, and this guy, if you look at the story, everybody knows that this road is dangerous, and everybody in those days, when you go on this kind of road, you would go with a group of people, a caravan, a whole bunch of people, but this guy is on his own, and that is being stubborn, careless, you can put it in so many ways, and what you're doing is you're just judging him, without even knowing why he was there in the first place, So we become very judgmental. And the other hand is the whole idea of prejudice, our own prejudices, If this is someone I don't know, and why should I care, So we go out there and we see people in dire need, and what runs inside our mind is, oh, this guy is a Malay, or this guy is a Chinese, or this guy is somebody else, or foreigner, or if this guy is, I don't want help, I shouldn't, and a lot of times it all comes to another place where we give a lot of excuses. I'm not free, I got some urgent matters that is more important. And when the priest and the Levites walking down, and they had this in mind, I just finished praying, I can't, because this mind might be dead, if I touch it, it'll be unclean, all the stuff that came into their mind, possibly came into their mind. And if we can see here, the point is that all of us have this tendency to be like this, and that is what Jesus is indicating. On our own, we are incapable of doing this. And even if we tried to do it, we were doing it for all the wrong reasons. We'll be doing it so that people will recognize us or affirm us or whatever that reason is. And it's got nothing to do with God himself and what he's called us to do. So we don't have what it takes to be good in the story, and that's who we are, and we would always do the opposite. There are so many people that crosses us on a daily basis. They are like the injured man in the story. There are numerous times where we know we could have done or even said something to that person who was hurting, but we didn't do it for whatever that reason is, Lano, we would choose to just walk on the other side. And Jesus turns the story around again, and he, this time around, he tells what the Samaritan does. On the contrary, Jesus tells us that the Samaritan did the very, very opposite, Lano, and he offered mercy and love in tangible and costly ways. He saw the wounded man on the side of the road. He didn't close his eyes. He didn't walk away. He helped. He allowed something to happen in his heart. He hadn't become abrasive or even hard and cruel, even with the cruel encounters he had. He's a Samaritan. He felt compassion, identified with that man at the moment. He acknowledged and deeply experienced his feeling and of compassion. He was willing to risk his own safety. And you see, because of all these things in his heart, he bandaged the wound, pouring his own precious wine, put the man on the donkey and walked. He brought the guy to an inn, and therefore he restricted his own plans or whatever that he was actually doing at that particular time, and detoured for the sake of this guy. He took personal care of the injured man and stayed the night and to help him, and then he paid the innkeeper 2 days' wages actually, and he was willing to follow up, to come back and help, and he even told the man, the caregiver, that whatever that needs to be done, you do it and I will pay it up. So we see Jesus saying this in his last question to the lawyer: which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robber? And the expert of the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. So Jesus told him, go and do likewise. Church, when we see this story, there's only one person in the history of this world that fits this depiction. He is Jesus himself. We were the ones that were bruised, and Christ gave himself to save us. We did not deserve this kind of mercy and compassion, but it was rendered to us for free. It was the act of God's grace and love that actually brought healing into our lives. It is that love, His love, that rescued us from our misery of sin. Even after this story, right, the lawyer kind of agreed that the Samaritan was an amazing neighbor. He did. But because of his hatred and his prejudice towards the Samaritan, he refused to acknowledge it in his statement. He used the word, the one who had mercy on him. He never used the Samaritan. So there's, when you look at the Jewish people, they will not use the word good and Samaritan together. And it doesn't make sense to them. The Samaritans are bad people. And that is right to a certain extent. If you look at it, who did they reject? They rejected the Christ. They rejected the gospel of grace and mercy. And we did it so. And you can read Isaiah and see the element of what was despised. The whole old Isaiah. But I'll just take a few verses and just show you what it means. And he was despised and rejected by mankind. He, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one who from whom people hide their faces. He was despised. And we held him low, in low esteem, Surely he took our pains and bore our sufferings, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgression, he was crushed by our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own ways, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And so we can see, when Jesus used the word, go and do likewise. Not that the people were, all these things are acceptable within our hearts. Not that it is easy to do, and not that when we do all these things, we are going to be accepted for what it is, for what we have done. The Bible does say in John 15:18-19, and this is Jesus saying to his disciples, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own, and as it is, and you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. We cannot understand mercy if we have never received it. We don't know how to be compassionate if we have not received the compassion of Jesus Christ. We cannot be gracious if we don't understand the grace that was shown to us. Church, the whole idea is that we understand, or we need to learn to understand, that we are utter sinners. We are broken. We are like the man at the side of the road. We are like the priest and the Levite who will walk away. We don't have what it takes. So when Jesus said, do likewise, he tells us to simply follow him. And we will see in the end of the Gospels that Jesus laid his life for us. We will see at the end of the Gospel that Jesus walked the pain, the shame. He took it all on himself. And the cross was the answer. What lies within the core of our Christianity is our understanding of how much he loved me and you. Our sincere approach in that understanding and applying that love in our daily lives, when we take what we see in him and we start to work that out in our lives, when we see what Jesus would do for the broken and we would say, Lord, help me to do it, being likewise, our deep desire, church, the core of what lies within our Christianity should be a desire to know him, to know why he did it for us, to know why the cross was important, to know why he came down, leaving his throne and sovereignty, to know why he walked among us, to know why that was what he would lay down for our being, for our sake. And that's why Paul says in Philippians 3:10-12, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation of his suffering and becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. The history of Israel, if you read, has led the whole bunch of the Jewish people to a hardened heart. It has led them to become passive, to abandon their call, to abandon the person they were called to be. A royal priesthood, a representation of the kingdom of God. They forgo that because of the situation that was around them. They allowed all these things to harden their heart. And they forgot what was at the core of who they were. They forgot the deliverance of Egypt. They forgot what it meant. And here Jesus is reminding us that we are called to represent Him. That we are called to tell the world that we understand the pain. We understand what it is, because we are like that. And when we see the gospel and the work of Christ in our lives, we know that there is hope, there is deliverance, there is power in Jesus Himself. Thus we do likewise. Let us pray, church. Father, we look at the cross. Our heads are bowed, Lord, because we stand broken. We know our capacity, Lord. We are injured within us, Lord. There is hurts, wounds, brokenness. Thus our response is always like the Levites, Lord, and the Pharisees in this story. And even the lawyer, Lord. We tend to justify ourselves, God. We tend to seem to do what we deem is right, Lord. And we are wrong. As we ask of you to forgive us, that you establish, Lord, the truth within the core of our Christianity, Lord. As we get up every morning, as we face the world, we do it likewise because of you, Lord. When we fail, we come back to the cross. We ask of you to teach us, Lord, that you will build a people, Lord, who would follow you because of you, Lord. Who would follow you because it is you who loved us. And there is no other way but your way, Lord. There is no other way to life but you, Jesus. So we ask of you, Lord, to teach our hearts, to heal our hearts, to lead us, to be likewise, God. So I thank you for the gospel within us, the truth that sets us free, that opens our eyes, Lord, to live a life like you would, Lord, in this world today, to be a good neighbor to our people, to the people around us. And to love the Lord, our God, with everything we have, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We commit this day into your hands. In Jesus' name.